with rabbits. 14 days in May.
Via satellite, this is the Mississippi Network.
This is the Delta's first choice for weather information each hour with up-to-date weather scans on WKZB-FM Stereo 95.3, serving Drew, Indianola, Moorhead, Edina, and the greater Delta area.
Jeff Pacelli was at the state penitentiary at Parchment today and filed this story.
A death row inmate at Parchment is scheduled to die in the gas chamber in 2 weeks. Edward Earl Johnson was convicted of a 1979 shooting death of Walnut Grove Marshal J.T. Trest. Johnson's attorneys and the American Civil Liberties Union say they've got a strategy to save the inmate from execution on the 20th of May.
Woo! Got your right, let's leave, man!
Ain't nothing but a game!
Oh, hey. Y'all out.
If you need to talk back to me, go to hell, man. Go to hell. Now get this new grind.
Thank you, boss.
I don't need that mouth.
What squad this is?
Lamo!
What we like to do?
Get
what we gonna do?
Get
all right, what are we?
Lamo!
That's what I'm talking about. Snatch it on back. Get it clean this time. Get it clean this time. Ain't nothing but a game.
This film is about the death penalty in the state of Mississippi and the effect it has on the staff and inmates as time runs out for one 26-year-old man, Edward Earl Johnson. Johnson has been appealing against his sentence for 8 years in the United States courts. He was convicted in 1979 of killing a Mississippi town marshal and the attempted rape of a 60-year-old woman. He has spent the last 8 years on this death row and has always professed his innocence.
I say we'll meet next Friday. The only thing that might cancel that is if he receives a stay of execution between now and then. So at this point in time, the Attorney General's office still feels very much like the execution will be a go. All of y'all know, you know, that could change right up to midnight, the 20th. I got one last thing to say, and then I'm going to try to start getting ready to get out of here. I will not tolerate one off-color remark by anybody on this staff about the execution. And just because I don't have to look forward to doing my job in this kind of situation doesn't mean that I can't be tolerant of others who perhaps look forward a little more eagerly to doing it. But they can look forward to it and still do it in a professional manner. And I assure you, I've never been more serious about a threat that I've made since I've been here. If I hear anything that I don't like from staff of this institution, they are going to answer to me directly and personally. I'm sure I'll be stuck with an action later, but the personnel department will have to clean it up, and that's a promise. I'll get rid of it.
Set 10.
This boy's family did not murder this police officer. This boy's family did not ask for their son to be in this situation. They didn't raise him to be in this predicament. And I've done some checking and looking into records and stuff as a matter of curiosity, and this guy isn't from some family of bozos, you know. This guy represents a situation that could happen to anybody. You know, you got some heartbroken parents that spent 7 years trying to figure out what the hell went wrong. We don't execute rapists and armed robbers anymore, and so when we do execute people, we execute people that situationally anybody could find themselves in the same shoes. You get a bad mixture of booze and bad character, or dope and booze and poor judgment, and my son, your daughter could end up on death row, and by God, that doesn't make me bad. That does not make me bad. As a parent, and that means that family is entitled to a modicum of respect from this department and this institution, I'm going to have it. And I'll tell you why I'm so adamant about that. Because I'm concerned about some of the kind of stuff that I hear rumbling-wise about people being upset about not being involved in this, that, and other thing. It's like I said to Don Hocut and a couple of others of you last night, I worry about people who are eager to stand in line to methodically strap somebody into a chair and kill them.
Yeah,
kidding.
That was a good move. I think I can get that one done.
I know you don't want to do that.
Yeah, I want to do that.
All right, boss.
The last time I was out here talking with you, I asked you whether or not, if this thing proceeds to the negative conclusion, whether you wanted any medication on the last day. And I asked you to think about that. What do you think?
I ain't giving it.
Well, I'm not going to ask you about it anymore, especially since your lawyer told you, you know, not to converse with me. Anything else on your mind? I guess this is going to be the last time you and I talk for a while.
They set the date for me for May 20th to be executed. If I don't get no relief from my review from the United States Supreme Court, I'll be executed. Sometime I'm depressed. All I think about, the funny thing is, I think about a future. Now that might seem kind of crazy. Now what future could I possibly have in knowing that I might supposedly be executed in the next 2 weeks? I can't plan on the future, but I think about the future. And I think about my past. The things I used to do, the people I know, you know, the people they care about, I think of them. I think of all that.
Scene of the crime, where Johnson allegedly robbed a 60-year-old woman and killed a local town marshal, an old Buick car was seen. Because Johnson owned a Buick, he was arrested with others and put in front of an identity parade. The woman who was robbed and nearly raped had known Edward Johnson most of his life.
She saw me. She told the investigators that she knew me and know that I wasn't the one that I broke in her home.
She told her that he wasn't.
She told me I wasn't. She said the person who broke in was about my size, but maybe a little heavier and had a full beard. And at that time, I don't have no beard, never had one. And after that, they let me go. They picked me up again. They said they had some questions to ask me about the gun, you know. And they kept badging about the gun. That didn't work, so they asked me would I be willing to take a lie detector test. So like I told him, you know, I ain't did nothing. Yeah, I take it. So I freely, you know, gave him permission. Yeah, I take a lie detector test. So that means they had to take me to Jackson. On the way to Jackson, they pulled over. They told me, you gonna tell us something that we want to hear. You ain't going. They said, nigga, all we have to say is that you jumped out the car and ran. And you know, then I didn't know what to think. I mean, I'm 18 years old. I'm side of the road with nobody around to say anything in my behalf. I mean, you know, it's on a Sunday evening late. I don't know nobody in this area. Nobody's behind me, following, none of my relatives with me. I got a sheriff and an investigator with me. And they talking crazy, you know. They both white and I'm black in the back seat in Mississippi at that, on the side of the road, and they done told me this. I don't know what to do. It was a choice of, you might say, telling them anything or go ahead and let them, you know, do what they said they were gonna do. So what they did then were, They turned on a tape recorder, and they went over the whole incident in their own words and made me repeat that into the tape recorder.
The officers returned with Johnson to the sheriff's department. Using the tape recording made on the side of the freeway, they wrote out a confession and asked Johnson to sign it.
All I asked, what is it? I ain't signing that. I don't know what this is. He said, don't worry about what it is. Don't read it. Just sign it. So I signed it.
Why?
Well, basically because he told me to sign it, and I was scared, you know. I don't know. But they got me by myself. Nobody knows where I'm at, you know. The last time that my relatives, anybody knew where I was at, was I was supposed to be on the way to Jackson, so that's where they thought I was at.
Did you ask for a lawyer?
No, I didn't.
Why not?
I don't remember. But really, I didn't know. You know, I didn't know no rights. When we was at the interstate, nobody didn't read me no rights. When my lawyers tried to attack the confessions, you know, as to how it was obtained, they didn't want to hear that. All they wanted to know was, look, we got it, and that's all that counts. He's guilty. I was guilty before. I was convicted and guilty before I even went to trial, you know? And the main part was that a white man was killed, and they have a black man accused of doing it, and they said he done it. And that was it. Last night, an officer came down and he told us that they was conducting some kind of test outside for the gas chamber. I gathered that they was trying it out, you know. And, you know, when he said that, it gripped me, you know. And, you know, they trying it out. Not only gripped me in my heart, but it gripped everybody else. Because it's the thoughts, you know. They just already assuming that they're gonna kill me. You could hear the same sounds, almost identical, same smell when they executed the last man. They said sound that smells sort of like almonds or cinnamon or something. If my appeals don't succeed, if they're rejected, I only have 12 days to do. In fact, everyone here is up there. Not only me, they're thinking about themselves. At what point will they have to face this?
Do you personally believe in the death penalty?
I guess the best way to answer that is to give a qualified yes. And I don't believe in it as a deterrent to crime because statistically, I don't think you can prove or disprove whether it's really effective as a deterrent or not. I think the death penalty represents nothing more than the ultimate punishment for the most heinous crimes that society feels have to be dealt with in a final fashion. I certainly have little trouble believing in it for child killers, for people who, like this young man, murdered a police officer. I'll have to admit, 20 years ago, I felt pretty strongly opposed to the death penalty. But then I was just back from Vietnam and was just beginning a career in corrections. And I think I thought that after what I'd seen and participated in Vietnam, that there had to be a better way to do things other than killing, no matter what the purpose was. But 20 years in corrections has a way of influencing your outlook on things. And I think there has to be an ultimate penalty.
Take this in there. I'm gonna come on around. I'll meet you on the other side. But I'll go ahead and let you through there, and I'll come meet you on the other side. Okay. Oh, okay.
Leo.
You gonna put them in front of the cell? Or?
It's kind of hard for him to sit down like that. If you can...
Yeah.
It may never get to the 20th.
It may.
God may intervene before the 20th ever gets here. He's, scripture talks about him working in mysterious ways. And
yeah.
So, you know, it may never get here. It may get here, and you may have to face it. But I know that what you're saying is that the frustration of getting up for tomorrow and then getting down again.
Getting down. But overall, this is what I think, Brad. Overall, it's all in the hands of God. You know? Yeah. It's you know, doubt clouds in at times.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, if you put your trust and your whole heart in it, in God, see, he erase all that doubt.
Yeah.
And give you a feeling of, you know, you relax. You just don't have no worries. Sunk in yet. It couldn't have, because if it all sunk in, I'd probably be done running my head through this wall or something. You know what I'm saying? But I look at it like this. 10 days. Have I ever been this close to death before? I guess I get afraid of time. Yeah, every time I hear a door squeak, I'm looking, you know, morning. I heard noise banging out there by the gas chamber myself. Well, they banged the door on me. I often look at it, gazing, you might say, thinking. But see, the thing about it, it's been there for the 7 years I've been here. There's nothing new to look at. There's nothing new to look at.
I'm sort of straddling the fence as far as the death penalty is concerned. I don't know, sometimes I am and sometimes I'm not. So really, I'm sort of straddling the fence. Something needs to be done for some of the crimes that's committed, but I'm not sure that the death penalty is the answer. I figure that if a person can't give a life, why should he be able to take one? I don't know. So I got mixed feelings about it. Regardless of whether it's the gas chamber, legal injection, or the electric chair, regardless of the method, you know, it'll take a lot. So really, whatever method they use doesn't really make any difference, you know, for that's concerned.
One thing common of all of us here is that we have no money. You know, we couldn't afford quality representation, the type of representation that would have made a fair trial possible. It takes money to fight the state. The state has all the resources in the world when they're trying to seek a death sentence. They have all the resources at their disposal. 9 times out of 10, we're stuck with an attorney who doesn't even have a moral conviction that the death penalty is wrong. You see, and what he does is function like an assistant to the DA. You know, the attorneys that represent most poor indigents are state-appointed attorneys. You see, when you look at them, you consider the economic factor, they're not the attorneys that do represent individuals in this situation at the trial level. They're not going against the state. The state pays their salary.
Statistically, in the United States at the moment, the figures show that if you're poor and black, you're more likely to end up on death row. Is that true?
In Mississippi, about 67% of the entire incarcerated population is poor, undereducated, black males. So, yes, statistically, the poor, undereducated minority is probably more likely to receive a death sentence based on the fact that they do not have funds to hire the best and the most appropriate legal assistance. The system is unjust, but the system and the fact that 60% of the people in prison are in Mississippi are minorities is just as unjust as that percentage of blacks, minorities, getting a death sentence. Either way, we're talking about an unjust situation that's based on the amount of funds that you have available or the lack of funds you have. So, no, the system is not perfect.
Sure, I'm on death row, and everyone expects me to say how wrong death penalty is. But I'm saying how wrong the death penalty is because I see how wrong it is. I'm experiencing it. Society hasn't experienced it because it hasn't touched society in the emotional or in the individual sense.
Do you believe in the death penalty for some crimes?
At one point I did. At one point. But seeing how the death penalty is being applied? No, I don't.
The majority of Americans, would think that a lot of people here on this death row have committed a lot of appalling crimes, murder, etc. And that you should be here, you're saying to most people.
Most people only hear what authority is telling them. As I said, they're not aware of the facts. They're not aware of the person. I feel they're being misled.
Well, I've been in this situation for 11 years. Initially, I was charged with capital murder and convicted in November 1976.
How have you coped with that 11 years? It's a long time.
It's a long time. I guess my belief in God has something to do with it. And I've asked myself that question before too. You know, as a black person, as a citizen of this country, you know, my people have always had to endure oppression and repression of this kind. You know, so it's part of my experience. You know, it's in my consciousness, you know, to cope. And I feel the same way about Earl. That, you know, I share the experience. What he's going through, I'm sharing that with him. The psychological torture that's involved, because that's what it is. You know, up to the point where they take him out and execute him. You know, it's torture. I mean, we all go through this. We all going through this with him, everybody here. But it's a bad time.
A death row inmate at Parchment is scheduled to die in the gas chamber in less than 2 weeks. Edward Earl Johnson was convicted of the 1979 shooting death of Walnut Grove Marshal J.T. Tress. Johnson's attorneys and the American Civil Liberties Union say they've got a strategy to save the inmate from execution on the 20th of May. They declined to give details of that plan, but did say there are racial factors to consider in the Johnson case. They say a recent study shows those who kill whites are more likely to be sentenced to death than those who kill blacks. Johnson is black and the victim was white. NewsRock 6 asked several of our viewers if they think Johnson should go to the gas chamber.
What do you think about the case? Do you think Johnson should be executed or not?
Well, I'm totally against the death penalty under any circumstances. I don't think that a life for a life accomplishes anything, so I don't think it should be executed at any rate, whether the person is black or white.
Do you think Johnson should be executed or not?
I will always believe if somebody murdered someone, that they should pay with it for it with their own life.
The conditions here are similar to slavery times. The only thing difference between now and 1860 is the year. The work gangs are just that, you know, that they're it's mostly like a make work situation. Whereas rather than just sitting idle as we do, they give them something to do, you know, cleaning up around here, cutting grass, digging ditches, you know, it's slavery modified into today's world. You know, it's just a big plantation that's been changed by the name. You know, instead of calling it a plantation, they call it a farm. But, you know, there's no difference in it.
What we've got here is the petition for you on, you know, going to the Mississippi Supreme Court. We have to go there first because you have to do that. There's absolutely no chance of actually achieving anything there because they've already made up their minds that they want to see you go on the 20th. But hopefully we'll be out of there in a couple of days so we can go straight into federal court. And that's where something's going to happen. I mean, when you get to read through this stuff, there's some really serious stuff in it, in the ineffectiveness claim would win in any reasonable case. Our problem, of course, is the publicity and the pressure that people are going to feel on all this. And in a fair world, you're going to win, but the world isn't always unfair, so we'll just have to keep our fingers crossed and keep praying. The facts of the case, though, is that you're a black kid in Leake County, which has got a bunch of Klan people, and they go around, yeah. they go around shooting freedom riders, and then they get acquitted, you know? And the fact is that you're accused of basically attempting to rape a white woman and killing a white police officer. Those are the two most heinous things that for a white person in Mississippi can happen. The fact that they misadvised you is one prong of what we have to show. The other side we have to show is that the result would have been different. Whatever happens, we're going to file in the federal district court on Friday because we can't wait any longer. We're talking about next Wednesday for the date. So if we file then, there are two options. Either we'll get a stay right away if he believes everything we've said in the petition, or he'll think there are some procedural bars and we've got to have a hearing on this, in which case we'll probably have a hearing on it Monday morning. And at that stage, he'll either give a stay or not give a stay Monday afternoon. The last two cases we've had got stayed the day before the thing.
Yeah.
So, you know, unfortunately, it's a nasty experience to get that close to the thing.
I'm beginning to feel the pressure personally a little bit more than I thought I would a week ago. Or even a month ago. I think probably that's increased since I've talked to this guy a couple of times. I haven't forgotten what he's here for, but there's no question that over a period of time, some of the barriers you might think would be there forever begin to come down a little bit. And I probably am going to avoid talking to Johnson any more than I have to from here on out until Tuesday, when I'll probably be spending a fair amount of time with him.
Are you sure he's guilty?
I think I'm as personally I'm as sure as I think you can be from reading the record of what happened. The testimony was pretty clear. I don't have any difficulty with that.
Are you expecting a stay?
I think it's a possibility, but I think because of the way things are going, that it could be rather late in the game. As these things go, I don't expect to stay if one comes until probably Monday at the earliest, and very possibly not until Tuesday.
All right, week's half over. We're almost to Friday. Can't get much better than that except payday. We're getting him up here now. We're going to have to talk to him and kind of just catch up on what arrangements he wants to make concerning the execution, his meals, and all that stuff.
Yeah.
How has he been behaving?
He, for the last 6 months, I've been over here. No problem. No problem so far.
How you doing, Edward? Okay?
Yep.
You all right?
Yep, come on.
Mind Come on in. Let me talk at you for a minute like we did last week. Barry, you want to call me?
Sonny, he's just fine. Our friend. He indicated to me quite freely without being prodded he's not having any trouble sleeping. He was aware by hearing on the news that the state Supreme Court had turned his stay down, but he's hopeful of other avenues. He is not wanting for anything. We covered again what arrangements he wanted to make for his family visiting. He again indicated he certainly realizes time is getting short, but he remains cautiously optimistic. And in short, he's probably in better mental condition than I. Thanks. The interesting thing is, of course, that his attorneys, in the motions they have filed with the court, they are asking the court now to stay his execution because he is not sane. And the basis upon which they have concluded he's not sane is that he is too calm. Anybody as close to being executed as he is should not be nearly as calm about the whole thing as he is. So they're obviously grasping for straws, which, you know, is understandable. They're doing their job. But it suggests that they really just haven't got much left to deal with.
Now a convicted killer's last resort. Today, the state Supreme Court denied a request to delay the execution of Edward Earl Johnson. He's scheduled to die next Wednesday. The nation's highest court previously refused to hear Johnson's last direct appeal. His lawyers are asking the justices to reconsider. The decision from Washington could come Monday. Johnson is on death row for killing a Walnut Grove town marshal.
In a way, I've been preparing this for 19 years in a career, preparing for it. I think that I understand, I'm beginning to understand, and probably will understand even better after the execution, why, strangely enough, over the years, at least in this country, a number of wardens who have performed large numbers of executions in the 30s and 40s when they were prevalent, nonetheless, despite the fact they did the jobs, pulled the switches or pushed the buttons many, many times, were nonetheless very strong opponents of capital punishment. They did the jobs, and they did it frequently, far more frequently than anybody in my generation of wardens would have to do. But nonetheless, they were opposed to it. And I have a feeling that when this is all over, I don't think I'm going to suddenly make any great changes and become an opponent of capital punishment. But I think that I'm going to be able to better understand the search for another way.
They're just starting to feel. It's just now people are starting to realize that it's probably going to happen. But there's still people that all the way up until the last day, even people that do get executed sometimes don't even believe they're going to be executed till they get in there. But it's starting to build a little bit, you know. Things, people are starting to be a little quieter, you know. The last little comments are being kicked around about it, and sad feelings are going around. Some people, maybe there's a little bit of fear. But it's just a line, and you just got to wait in line until it happens. And you got to watch all this happen, and it's just torture.
But then one thing that has helped me a great deal, I had an old minister tell me one time and reminded me that we're all under the death penalty. We're all dying. None of us has a guarantee of tomorrow. The only difference is these fellows has a date set. They know that such and such a date, I'm going to be placed in the gas chamber, and I'm going to die.
As of yesterday, the Attorney General's office was of the opinion that he would not be granted relief by the state Supreme Court. They have also filed a petition for clemency with the governor. It does not appear that the governor will grant relief on that request, although he has to have a hearing on it. His greatest hope at this point in time lies with the federal district court in Jackson, Judge Barber, who has handled this case on previous occasions. There is probably at least a 50-50 chance that Judge Barber will grant a stay of execution. However, there is some discussion as to how long the stay will be. It could be 6 months, it could be 2 months, it could be a week, it could be a few days. We're going to proceed on the assumption that even if the execution is stayed for the 20th, that it will not take too terribly long for the stay to be dissolved so that we can continue to be in a state of preparedness for this. I think probably, unless somebody moves very quickly today, and I honestly don't expect that, we're going to come down to the wire on this thing. The chamber has been
thoroughly examined by manufacturing reps and by us, and will be examined again by us Sunday and again Tuesday afternoon. So I don't expect any difficulties, but I want you all to be aware. For those of you who have a role in this thing, however indirect it may be, that if there's a malfunction of some kind, if the solution and the cyanide did not mix properly, the execution will be carried out. It's simply a process of having to clear the chamber and do it again. Obviously, I think everybody hopes that doesn't happen.
But I want this staff to be professional. We're going to discuss how we did, what we did, and what we can do to improve it, because there are going to be other executions here in the next year, a year and a half, 2 years. This boy's mother is a part-time law enforcement official. He comes from a relatively good family. They are entitled to some dignity in terms of the way we do our jobs. Now, for those of you who are in the custody ranks in particular, and believe me, I understand. Because I've worn the uniform too, I understand this man killed a police officer. That doesn't change anything. If he killed one of your best friends on the guard force, we'd still have to carry this out in a responsible fashion.
We have to repent, and we have to come to the knowledge of the truth. We have to accept Jesus Christ as our Savior. And I know, Edward, that God is working on you. I see evidence of things taking place in your life, that I know that God's not left you alone, that He's with you.
I really feel it, although, like you said, there still need to be a deeper repentance on my part. And I just have to wait and let God work on me with it.
I've seen things in you that I see God dealing, and I see God bringing you to a place of repentance. But you don't have anything to worry about, not a thing. But you know, it's like I told you, God knows your beginning and He knows your end. He knows that He knows Edward Johnson better than me, better than anybody. God knows you, because God created you.
Defense attorneys for convicted murderer Edward Earl Johnson tried again today to postpone the execution of their client, now scheduled for this coming Wednesday. Governor Bill Allain, however, refused to make a decision on granting executive clemency, saying that was premature. As of this time, though, it appears the execution may take place as scheduled. Jeff Buscelli was at the state penitentiary at Parchment today and filed the story.
While his attorneys are reportedly employing more radical tactics to save their client, prison officials say that Johnson has all but resigned himself to his fate.
I heard last night on the news that someone had been in touch with Governor Allain to ask for a clemency. But he had told him that he wasn't making any decision that was premature at this time. You know, he was waiting till the outcome of my appeals. So he didn't deny clemency and he didn't grant it. So just waiting, you might say. Other than that, I understand, you know.
It's a long way.
Yeah, it's a tiring wait, you know. I think sometimes I might just have to wait up to that last moment, you know. Maybe the last hour, maybe the last minute, maybe the last second, who knows? I just got to prepare myself for that. Now I am prepared.
Able to be with everyone one time, you may say, having contact that I could really actually touch them and hug them and be with them, you know. That's a new experience because it's been through a while, you might say, through a screen, through a bar.
Always?
Yeah, always. For all the 7 years I've been here, it's been that way. this is just what you call, this is a special privilege, you know. So it's really a help, you know, to give me strength.
I'm just praying and ask the Lord to please change things. You know, he's a man who can change anything. Ain't nothing impossible for him to do. So I'm just praying that it will come on out. And maybe he will be back home with us.
You're a this woman in jail.
Part-time. And I know how they get confession out of people. They usually got a new technique. They don't beat them out. They had sting gun one time. That was eliminated. So now they got all the little ways to get confession out of them. You didn't really commit the crime because you're frightened. You'll say anything. If you have somebody have a gun pointed at you, I'd say anything myself. Maybe this way give me a chance to have a little life left.
It's not fair at all. I don't think it's fair. Nobody in the family thinks it's fair. People on the outside say it's not fair. It's just not fair, the way it was run, the way it was done. But one person can't do everything. People need help. So who's gonna help us?
Next week, it's gonna be rough here because you got black guys, and most guys that are here are black. And they gonna all feel close. They gonna get, most of them gonna unite. And it's gonna be rough. A lot of them gonna feel forever, which, it's gonna be rough for us also, you know, cause some of us been here 6 years, 10 and more, and we got close to him, you know, which we shouldn't be. But you can't help it when you're working around some guys like this, you know, this long a period of time. And then to see him actually have to go to the gas tank, we shouldn't be that way. But that's the way it is, and we can't do anything about it.
Do you think he did it?
I don't, you know, I can always say I don't believe we're even around me now. You know, for the last half years, I don't believe
it. Do you think an innocent man might be going to his death?
Possibility.
That's terrible.
Yeah.
Do many of the officers feel like you do?
I believe the majority of them around here do. But Edward, you know, he, like I say, everybody, you know, blacks around here. All the white and black officers, you know. He's an easy going fella, he don't get nobody in trouble, so you know.
But that's terrible, isn't it? The majority of officers here feel that he might not have done it.
Right.
Has he got bedding down there, Roger?
No, sir. Okay. Does not.
I don't know. You want two mattresses? No,
I just want this. I want
you to get that straightened out after you get set.
How you
doing? Where you going? All right.
Get your shower, shoes, yeah.
Does travel? Does
Edwin. Okay, I'll see you tomorrow.
All right.
Okay. Make sure he signed the check. Check on him specifically and ask, you know, see if he needs anything. Okay?
All right.
Move from my cell to
what you call, I guess, 24-hour watch. See, and they move you 72 hours before your execution is carried out. That's, you know, in case of limited people that's going by the CLUN. And easy access to the bank.
I really don't know what to say. All our hearts are with you. Good luck. I'm hoping you're going to stay in the next 48 hours.
I expect so. I expect. This waiting process.
Service. We stayed in service after we left from here at about 12 o'clock.
And little Watson still the pastor?
Yes, he's still in good service. I said, Jay, you keep the spirit. Mm-hmm. You know prayer will change things, so it's in the hands of the Lord. Everybody's praying for you. Hope you're praying for yourself, which I'm quite sure you are.
Yeah.
So you got the community behind, you know. They believe in your innocence, and they're doing all they can. And who knows? It's not them, just not the last day yet.
Yeah, but they finally believe me. They said that. They finally believe me now.
Well, yeah, they finally believe me.
Well, we're down to a little under 36 hours and still have no stay of execution. One more avenue of appeal was closed this morning. The U.S. Supreme Court turned down a request from the inmate to rehear his petition that they denied a week ago. So basically, it comes down to his last chances are with the state Supreme Court and the governor's office or the federal district court in Jackson.
Ooh, you're like the sun, chasing all of the rain away. When you come around, you bring brighter days. You're the perfect one for me. And I will love lovely soul. I can't find the ways to let you know, but you can't be sure I'm yours for always.
I don't have any personal animosity towards him. He committed a very, very serious crime. More than a crime of passion, and more than what somebody would do if they were just caught by surprise or frightened in the act of committing a property crime. I mean, he shot the man 5 times. But he's a guy who's been on death row almost 8 years, and nobody's ever heard from him. You know, he's a typical death row prisoner. Very quiet.
You're sure of his guilt?
Yeah, I don't have any qualms at all about him having committed the crime. No.
I will love you so for always.
Don't we can't cut that off.
Undoubtedly, I think the legal system has always worked on the basis of some difference in terms of what a private attorney, a private, well-paid attorney can accomplish for somebody and what a public defender can accomplish. That's a flaw in the system, but I don't think it has to be a fatal flaw. I think we have to worry about, is the person guilty? Did he clearly, beyond all reasonable doubt, commit the crime?
Well, you know, he told me to call him about 6. Mm-hmm. No doubt. You want to call your office? Okay. Okay. All right. He just met with Judge Barber. They had a hearing on some of the procedure things that was in that appeal that he filed. And he's in the hearing right now.
He's in
Clyde,
the
yes. That was Clyde. Ken Rose. Yeah. He told me to call back in about another hour. I need to let me know something.
All right.
This is a classic situation. Wardens find themselves, you make choices about your death row inmates, you know. And it doesn't come down to a case of whether you feel any affection or emotion about a given case. That's not the situation with this guy at all. But what happens is, last night, for instance, when I went down there to move him, I had to walk by the cell of another inmate who deserves to be on death row, who killed a police officer in cold blood and has a prior criminal record. There are others here on the road that I'd much prefer to take to the gas chamber than this guy. I think I have found myself having to work through that more than anything else. It's not a case of emotion or affection for this kid. It's just a case of, geez, you know, I'm not saying he doesn't deserve to go, but maybe he ought to be 19th in line instead of first.
All right. All right. Good morning.
They're determined to execute me. I'm determined for them not to execute me, because I don't believe that. Considering the way the case has been, I don't see it. And I don't believe it for 1 minute. And I refuse to break anyway. I can't do that. I refuse to. Now, it's good now that I can be, you know, around my family to hold them, you know, and I'm sanctum and stuff like that. And that really give me a good feeling. They give me more strength, and I give them strength. We draw off each other. And another thing is that, yeah, I think about from non-contact in 7 years, you know, I think about all the other things I missed. You know, like I haven't even seen the moon in, say, about 3 times in 7 years. And out of that 7 years, there hasn't been one time that I've actually got a chance to go outside and to look up at the stars and the moon, you know, and it's a weird feeling. You know, it even though I'm chained down, but it's a weird feeling that be able to look up and see the moon, the actual moon and the stars up on their heads. And the little one, I can't do nothing but get a glance of it. So, you know, it's just a feeling. You feel good. You feel almost free, even though I know the circumstances in a way. What do you got, you know, now? I'd like that again, you know, and I expect to get it again.
It's strange, it's not just the inmates here. Mm-hmm. This last 24 hours we're praying for you, it's also most of the staff on death row are hoping for a stay.
Yeah.
And of course, myself and the film crew have been filming you for 2 weeks now.
Yeah. See, no, it don't matter how you portray a person to be. You say dangerous, you say vicious, it might fight at the drop of a hat. That's the reports that's been given all this time, all these years, people here. But once you get to know somebody in a personal way, well, you can't help but be emotionally involved. It's like the gods. They've known me for 7 years. We kidded around, we might share things together. And that gets them involved just like in a way with the family, because they stay here actually as much as they are at home. You begin to get some kind of relationship. They can't stop that. That can't be stopped.
Circuit denied some of the claims that was on the petition. So now they're going to file it in the Fifth Circuit. On the way now. So he'll be up here in the next 3 or 4 hours.
Just keep praying.
Meanwhile, Edward Earl Johnson sits on death row in Parchman, scheduled to die in the gas chamber at a minute after midnight. Don Cabana, warden of Parchman and acting corrections commissioner, says he's spoken with Johnson every day since the decision to execute him was made.
My conversations with him, I'm impressed with the fact that he's at peace with himself and has accepted the reality of the situation right now.
Cabana says the final stages of preparation at the prison have already begun. For this afternoon, Cabana says an institutional emergency situation will be declared, during which traffic through the prison will be limited as the final hours are counted down. Earlier today, Judge William Barber denied a request to stay the execution. Johnson's lawyers have appealed to the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals.
In the name of Jesus Christ, who died for us. Amen.
I'm getting some salt and pepper out of the kitchen.
We do still have an execution that is proceeding on schedule. The Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals has affirmed the conviction, I guess, and denied a request for a stay of execution from Edward Earl Johnson. Filings have already taken place with the United States Supreme Court. The Attorney General's office advises me that we may hear from the U.S. Supreme Court within an hour. I think it's fair to say that we do not expect the
U.S. Supreme Court to issue any stays in this matter. It will apparently come down to the governor's office and any clemency petitions he may entertain. I can't conjecture about that. My impression from my conversations with the governor and the governor's office the last 2 days is that is not a strong likelihood either. So we are prepared to carry out this execution at 12:01 tomorrow morning or as soon after that time as possible.
Chapman, do you think Edward L. Johnson murdered that sheriff 7 years ago?
No, I do not. I've talked with him on several occasions and he has more than one time told me that he did not do the crime that he's here for. He did not assault the lady that was supposedly assaulted, and I believe him. His attorney says there are several good points that should be looked at, but yet it's so far in the game until nobody will hear of it, which doesn't make sense at all to me. In a society that's supposed to be civilized and a caring society that cares for those people that are really down and out or downtrodden, certainly Earl would be at this point, I think.
So you're saying, in your opinion, mm-hmm. an innocent man is going to go to the gas chamber tonight?
I believe that. Yes.
Well, this morning we lost in federal district court, not till noon, so that was later than we expected, and to be quite honest, I expected to win there, I really did. We had a hearing last night, everything went very well, and we had to win. The judge was out to get us, and he really did get us very badly, and after that I thought things were pretty much all over. Then we went to the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals, and we went to the judge's chambers there in Jackson. As I went into his office to file the appeal, I looked on the word processor and he'd already written the denial of the appeal before we'd even done it. However,
He'd already written it.
It was running out on the printer before we'd even filed the appeal, and he denied his oral argument. However,
Is that constitutional?
Well, I mean, who knows what's constitutional with these people, but it's absolutely abnormal and it's thoroughly unfair. But fortunately, in an effort to make things even worse for us, he really messed up. I mean, he hadn't considered it properly and he really screwed up. Consequently, he gave us another issue for the Supreme Court when we were beginning to run out of issues, and we went to the Supreme Court at about 8 o'clock this evening, 4 hours before the date was due. I'm pretty sure we've got 4 judges there. We always have 2, and we may have 2 more. We need 1 more, probably, to get us a stay, and we've got a real good issue. So, you know, you can't be confident on these things, but there's something going on, I hope. So, we'll see. I think we've got now about 3 hours left. That's not that abnormal. I mean, these things normally go down to the wire if you lose in the Circuit Court. The trouble is they've tried to screw us so badly and everyone's out to get Edward L. at the moment. We're going to be lucky. There's also the governor and we're going to be lucky there if we get that, but we'll see, we'll see, we'll hang in.
In just about 2 hours, Edward Earl Johnson will be in the gas chamber at Parchman Penitentiary, and unless the courts or the governor intervene between now and then, Johnson will die for the murder of a Mississippi lawman.
Johnson's attorneys are expected to fight the execution to the last, but Parchman officials are proceeding as planned, and at 4 p.m. today, the penitentiary entered a state of emergency operation.
Mm-hmm.
About 1 hour before the scheduled execution, Johnson will be moved from death row to the last night room, as it's referred to, where he will be held until taken to the gas chamber for execution scheduled for 1 minute after midnight.
In the event that there may be a study and the Attorney General's office works to dissolve that study, the state has until midnight before the 21st for the execution to go through.
According to state law, execution witnesses will include a representative from the sheriff's office, two ministers, two physicians, and five media representatives, two family members, and two members of the victim's family may be present if they so request. It's not clear that any such request has yet been made. In March, March 6th. Today was the date.
Very bad. I'm still not without hope. You know, I still just can't give up. But it looks real bad. You know, it looks very bad now. Everyone, you know, is with him, you know. Like, I feel just, you know, as much a part of him as a person could be. You know, like, I became as close as a brother to him, you know. And they've kept him here 7 years, you know, killing him daily. Well, now they're going to finally kill him, you know. Everyone here is dying tonight, you know, a little. A part of them, you know, like, I can never be the same after this. I can never be the same, you know, like, we're supposed to be vicious and cruel, but this goes beyond anything that anyone could ever do. This, Lord have mercy.
Call Kenny and see what happens to the governor, right? All right, have him let us know as soon as we can. Bye-bye.
What's the score? 7-2,
for Christ's sake.
Yes.
No, yeah, not cool.
It's time, son, to move to the isolation cell, okay? Get the door.
Hello, my brother.
Hello, Sam. Sure.
Take care.
Chaplain's gonna need to come on back through there in just a second. We've got some staunch friends here. We're gonna get through this together. Did you eat any of that shrimp they brought you this evening?
Oh, yeah.
You said you'd never tried shrimp before, is that right?
No, yeah.
Huh. Hallelujah, peace I leave with you. Peace I give unto you. Peace I leave with you. Peace I give unto you. Peace I leave with you. Peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, give unto you. Peace I leave with you.
Are you sleepy?
I'm going to have to sleep in a minute. No, I'm sleeping. I'm just having to be tired. Yeah. I guess it all, you know, comes in on you. That just comes in on you, you get tired, strained, you know, you're waiting. Well, call me, come through. Gotta keep everybody else up.
Yeah. I'm not really down there. Yeah. I'm sleeping.
When we take you inside, they'll have to attach some little round, I forget what you call them, doohickeys that go to the electrocardiograph machine. They may need to remove a little hair to do that. That will happen at about a quarter till. And at that point in time, we'll have about 5 minutes before we remove you from the isolation cell, okay? I've got about 11:33. Got about 12 minutes until the medic comes in and about 17 minutes until we remove you from the room, okay?
Hey, Ralph. We would like to leave you with people here, okay? Mm. I think it's time for us to go. Obviously, we want to say goodbye to you. Our hearts are with you, and we're still praying for you.
Hey, Paul.
Take it easy. Good luck. I want to get you.
Ladies and gentlemen, at 12:06 a.m., Wednesday, May 20th, Edward Earl Johnson was executed in the lethal gas chamber here at the Mississippi State Penitentiary in conformance with the sentence of the Circuit Court of Leake County. I'll be glad to entertain any questions you may have.
Do you have any last statements?
Yes, he did. He indicated his innocence, and that he regretted the situation, but that he bore no ill will towards anyone, and he was thankful that the process was coming to a close for himself and his family, and stated that he was not guilty.
How long between the time the crystals hit the tray and the time the monitor showed cardiac arrest?
Between the time the gas struck his face and the time cardiac arrest was pronounced was approximately 12 minutes. He was unconscious in less than a minute.
If we could, let's hear from the lawyer. He knew it.
Everyone's been very calm and collected about this. Well, let me tell you, I'm not calm and I'm not collected. I just came from talking with the family, and I asked you rhetorically what I was meant to say. What I was meant to say, why it happened. I stayed with Edward Johnson. I had a privilege to stay with Edward Johnson for the last hours of his life. And I can say he was a lot more calm than I was. And I can only say this. When the family asked me why, all I could say was, it's a sick world. It's a sick world. Thank you.
With rabbits. 14 days in May.
Via satellite, this is the Mississippi Network.
This is the Delta's first choice for weather information each hour with up-to-date weather scans on WKZB-FM Stereo 95.3, serving Drew, Indianola, Moorhead, Edina, and the greater Delta area.
Jeff Buscelli was at the state penitentiary at Parchment today and filed the story.
A death row inmate at Parchment is scheduled to die in the gas chamber in 2 weeks. Edward Earl Johnson was convicted of a 1979 shooting death at Walnut Grove Marshal J.T. Trest. Johnson's attorneys and the American Civil Liberty Union say they've got a strategy to save the inmate from execution on the 20th of May.
Woo! Got your right, let's leave, man!
Ain't nothing but a game!
Oh, hey. If you need to talk back to me, go to hell, man. Go to hell. Now get this new grind.
Thank you, boss.
I don't need that mouth.
Tell me what squad this is.
Lambo!
What we like to do.
Get
what we gonna do.
Get
all right, what are we?
Lambo!
That's what I'm talking about. Snatch it on back. Get it clean this time. Get it clean this time. Ain't nothing but a game.
This film is about the death penalty in the state of Mississippi and the effect it has on the staff and inmates as time runs out for one 26-year-old man, Edward Earl Johnson. Johnson has been appealing against his sentence for 8 years in the United States courts. He was convicted in 1979 of killing a Mississippi town marshal and the attempted rape of a 60-year-old woman. He has spent the last 8 years on this death row and has always professed his innocence.
I say we'll meet next Friday. The only thing that might cancel that is if he receives a stay of execution between now and then. So at this point in time, the Attorney General's office still feels very much like the execution will be a go. All of y'all know, you know, that could change right up to midnight, the 20th. I got one last thing to say, and then I'm going to try to start getting ready to get out of here. I will not tolerate one off-color remark by anybody on this staff about the execution. And just because I don't have to look forward to doing my job in this kind of situation doesn't mean that I can't be tolerant of others who perhaps look forward a little more eagerly to doing it, but they can look forward to it and still do it in a professional manner. And I assure you, I've never been more serious about a threat that I've made since I've been here. If I hear anything that I don't like from staff of this institution, they are going to answer to me directly and personally. I'm sure I'll be stuck with an action later, but the personnel department will have to clean it up, and that's a promise. I'll get rid of it.
Set in.
This boy's family did not murder this police officer. This boy's family did not ask for their son to be in this situation. They didn't raise him to be in this predicament. And I've done some checking and looking into records and stuff as a matter of curiosity, and this guy isn't from some family of bozos, you know. This guy represents a situation that could happen to anybody. You know, you got some heartbroken parents that spent 7 years trying to figure out what the hell went wrong. We don't execute rapists and armed robbers anymore, And so when we do execute people, we execute people that situationally anybody could find themselves in the same shoes. You get a bad mixture of booze and bad character, or dope and booze and poor judgment, and my son, your son, your daughter could end up on death row, and by God, that doesn't make me bad. That does not make me bad as a parent, and that means that that family is entitled to a modicum of respect from this department and this institution. I'm going to have it. And I'll tell you why I'm so adamant about that. Because I'm concerned about some of the kind of stuff that I hear rumbling-wise about people being upset about not being involved in this, that, and other thing. It's like I said to Don Hocut and a couple of others of you last night, I worry about people who are eager to stand in line to methodically strap somebody into a chair and kill them.
Last time I was out here talking with you, I asked you whether or not, if this thing proceeds to the negative conclusion, whether you wanted any medication on the last thing. And I asked you to think about that. What do you think?
I didn't give you.
Well, I'm not going to ask you about it anymore, especially since your lawyer told you, you know, not to converse with me. Anything else on your mind? I guess this is going to be the last time you and I talk for a while.
They set a date for me for May 20th to be executed. If I don't get no relief from my review from the United States Supreme Court, I'll be executed. Sometime I'm depressed. I mean, all I think about, the funny thing is, I think about a future. Now that might seem kind of crazy. Now what future could I possibly have in knowing that I might supposedly be executed in the next 2 weeks? I can't plan on the future, but I think about the future. And I think about my past. The things I used to do, the people I know, you know, the people that care about, I think of them. I think of all that.
Scene of the crime, where Johnson allegedly robbed a 60-year-old woman and killed the local town marshal, an old Buick car was seen. Because Johnson owned a Buick, he was arrested with others and put in front of an identity parade. The woman who was robbed and nearly raped had known Edward Johnson most of his life.
She saw me. She told the investigators that she knew me and know that I wasn't the one that I broke in her home.
She told her that he wasn't.
She told me I wasn't. She said the person who broke in was about my size, but maybe a little heavier and had a full beard. And at that time, I don't have no beard, never had one. And after that, they let me go. They picked me up again. They said they had some questions. They asked me about the gun, you know. And they kept badging about the gun. That didn't work, so they asked me would I be willing to take a lie detector test. So like I told him, you know, I ain't did nothing. Yeah, I take it. So I freely, you know, gave him permission. Yeah, I take a lie detector test. So that means they had to take me to Jackson. On the way to Jackson, they pulled over. They told me You gonna tell us something that we wanna hear, or you ain't going. He said, nigga, all we have to say is that you jumped out the car and ran. And you know, then I didn't know what to think. I'm 18 years old. I'm side of the road with nobody around to say anything in my behalf. I mean, you know, it's on a Sunday evening late. I don't know nobody in this area. Nobody's behind me, following me. None of my relatives with me. I got a sheriff and an investigator with me. And they talking crazy, you know. They both white and I'm black in the back seat in Mississippi, dead. On the side of the road, and they done told me this. I don't know what to do. It was a choice of, you might say, telling them anything, or go ahead and let them, you know, do what they said they were gonna do. So what they did then were, they turned on a tape recorder, and they went over the whole incident in their own words, and made me repeat that into the tape recorder.
The officers returned with Johnson to the sheriff's department. Using the tape recording made on the side of the freeway, they wrote out a confession and asked Johnson to sign it.
All I asked, what is it? I ain't signing that. I don't know what this is. He said, don't worry about what it is. Don't read it. Just sign it. So I signed it.
Why?
Well, basically because he told me to sign it and I was scared, you know. I don't know, but they got me by myself. Nobody knows who I'm at, you know. The last time that my relatives, anybody knew where I was supposed to be on the way to Jackson, so that's what they thought I was at.
Did you ask for a lawyer?
No, I didn't.
Why not?
I don't remember. But really, I didn't know. You know, I didn't know no rights. When we decided to the interstate, nobody didn't read me no rights. When my lawyers tried to attack the confessions, you know, as to how it was obtained, they didn't want to hear that. All they wanted to know was, look, we got it, and that's all that counts. He's guilty. I was guilty before. I was convicted and guilty before I even went to trial, you know? And the main part was that a white man was killed, and they have a black man accused of doing it, and they said he done it. And that was it. Last night,
officer came down and he told us that they was conducting some kind of test outside for the gas chamber. I gathered that they was trying it out, you know. And you know, when he said that, it gripped me, you know. And, you know, they trying it out. Not only gripped me in my heart, but it gripped everybody else. Because it's the thoughts, you know. They just already assuming that they're gonna kill me. You could hear the same sounds, almost identical, same smell when they executed the last man. They said sound that smells so like almonds or cinnamon or something. If my peers don't succeed, if they're rejected, I only have 12 days to do. In fact, everyone here is up there. Not only me, they're thinking about it. They're thinking about themselves. At what point would they have to face this?
Do you personally believe in the death penalty?
I guess the best way to answer that is to give a qualified yes. And I don't believe in it as a deterrent to crime because statistically, I don't think you can prove or disprove whether it's really effective as a deterrent or not. I think the death penalty represents nothing more than the ultimate punishment for the most heinous crimes that society feels have to be dealt with in a final fashion. I certainly have little trouble believing in it for child killers, for people who, like this young man, murdered a police officer. I'll have to admit, 20 years ago, I felt pretty strongly opposed to the death penalty. But then I was just back from Vietnam and was just beginning a career in corrections. And I think I thought that after what I'd seen and participated in Vietnam, that there had to be a better way to do things other than killing, no matter what the purpose was. But 20 years in corrections has a way of influencing your outlook on things. And I think there has to be an ultimate penalty.
Take this in there. I'm gonna come on around. I'll meet you on the other side. But I'll go ahead and let you through there, and I'll come meet you on the other side. Okay. Oh, I've got to go.
Leo.
Here. You gonna put him in the front of the cell?
It's kind of hard for him to sit down like that.
It may never get to the 20th.
It may.
God may intervene before the 20th ever gets here. He's, scripture talks about him working in mysterious ways. And,
yeah.
So, you know, it may never get here. It may get here, and you may have to face it. But I know that what you're saying is that the frustration of getting up for tomorrow and then getting down again.
Getting down. But overall, this is what I think, Captain. Overall, it's all in the hands of God. Mm-hmm. It's you know, doubt clouds in at times.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, if you put your trust and your whole heart in it, in God, see, he erase all that doubt.
Yeah.
And give you a feeling of, you know, you relax. You just don't have no worries. Sunk in yet. It couldn't have, because if it all sunk in, I'd probably be done running my head through his walls. You know what I'm saying? But I look at it like this. 10 days. Have I ever been this close to death before? I guess I get afraid of time. Yeah, every time I hear a door squeak, I'm looking, you know, mourning. I heard noise banging out there by the gas chamber myself. Well, they banged the door on me. I often look at it, gazing, you might say. Thinking. But see, the thing about it, it's been there for the 7 years I've been here. There's nothing new to look at. There's nothing new to look at.
I'm sort of straddling the fence as far as the death penalty is concerned. I don't know, sometimes I am and sometimes I'm not. So really, I'm sort of straddling the fence. Something needs to be done for some of the crimes that's committed. But I'm not sure that the death penalty is the answer. I figure that if a person can't give a life, why should he be able to take them? I don't know. I sort of got mixed feelings about it. Regardless of whether it's the gas chamber, legal injection or the electric chair, regardless of the method, you know, it'll take a life. So really, whatever method they use doesn't really make any difference, you know, for that's concerned.
One thing common of all of us here is that we have no money. You know, we couldn't afford quality representation, the type of representation that would have made a fair trial possible. It takes money to fight the state. The state has all the resources in the world when they're trying to seek a death sentence. They have all the resources at their disposal. 9 times out of 10, we're stuck with an attorney who doesn't even have a moral conviction that the death penalty is wrong. You see, and what he does is function like an assistant to the DA. You know, the attorneys that represent most poor indigents are state-appointed attorneys. You see, when you look at them, you consider the economic factor, they're not. The attorneys that do represent individuals in this situation at the trial level, they're not going against the state. The state pays their salary.
Statistically, in the United States at the moment, the figures show that if you're poor and black, you're more likely to end up on death row. Is that true?
In Mississippi, about 67% of the entire incarcerated population is poor, undereducated, black males. So, yes, statistically, the poor, undereducated minority is probably more likely to receive a death sentence based on the fact that they do not have funds to hire the best and the most appropriate legal assistance. The system is unjust, but the system and the fact that 60% of the people in prison are in Mississippi are minorities is just as unjust as that percentage of blacks, minorities getting a death sentence. Either way, we're talking about an unjust situation that's based on the amount of funds that you have available or the lack of funds you have. So, no, the system is not perfect.
Sure, I'm on death row, and everyone expects me to say how wrong the death penalty is. But I'm saying how wrong the death penalty is because I see how wrong it is. I'm experiencing it. Society hasn't experienced it because it hasn't touched society. The emotional or in the individual sense.
Do you believe in the death penalty for some crimes?
At one point I did. At one point. But seeing how the death penalty is being applied, no, I don't.
The majority of Americans would think that a lot of people here on this death